righty, I'm going to call the meeting to order at 6:04. And first thing on our agenda is our presentation of our audit review with Tom Scanlon. You're up.
First up, audit.
First up, we want to get you in here and let you get out of here.
Get home early.
We won't tell if you don't.
I just so you know, you have 2 minutes.
Everything was good, I'm out of here. Hopefully everyone reports in the mail and then, I'm trying to walk through it all this with you, I'm trying to explain everything to you, so it makes sense of it. Actually, I got three reports. We'll do the thicker one first, that's your financial statement. The audit went good, we had no difficulties with management, we had no difficulties encountered during the audit. We made no significant adjustments to your financial statements, which is good. Your financial reporting is excellent. You know, what comes through your system, press bills, is, your accounting is just right up there. How would you like to say that one? So it was a good, smooth audit. Just kind of like walk you through on pages 3 and 4. That is your audit opinion. That's the whole purpose of an audit. We're opining on your financial statements. You have a clean opinion. It's unmodified. This is what bonding companies will look at right here. They probably look at nothing else in your report, but this right here. And your granting agencies will look at this report. For instance, if you did get a qualification, which if you didn't report OPIB on your financial statements or compensated absence, we're in accordance with GAAP. You may fall to a second tier when you're applying for grants, and the federal government right now has a policy if you have a qualified opinion, you're going to go through review and may not get any federal awards. Got a couple communities in that category, so it does happen. So I know your school committee management pays more attention to the management letter, but this is probably the most important document right here. That's outside of management, we're looking at this. And now kind of walk through your financial statements, try to make understanding from them. On pages 12 and 13, these are your entity-wide financial statements. It's full accrual basis of accounting. This is kind of accountant's euphoria. Not too sure this financial statement really makes sense to management. As you can see, capital assets is on there. It recognizes depreciation. None of that is in your budget when you're setting your budget. Some of the aspects to take out of this is go down under net position, you'll see unrestricted, it's a negative 8.3 million. You don't like to see negative numbers in your balance sheet, especially in net position. The two drivers of that is your OPEB obligation, which is 5.9 million, and your net pension liability. Those were accounting standards that required you to put them on your financial statements. Your net pension liability, in theory, should go down. Every year you're getting an assessment from the county, and you're paying it, and I think you're due to be funded 2028, I think, at the county level. So you're on a payment schedule, you're going to have that funded. Last year was the first year that liability showed on your financial statements. I know I'm getting to accountant speak, but you do have liability with unfunded pensions out there. You have people that are outside the teacher's retirement system that are getting a benefit and you have to pay every year. That liability never showed on your financial statements before, and last year was the first year and this is the second year. But there is a plan to have that go down. The OPEB liability, I know we've talked about that. Nauseam, it's 5.9 million, increased about 600,000. What OPEB is the promise to pay a portion of your retiree's health insurance at a future date. So there is some legitimacy to it. I'm not too sure it's $5.9 million on your balance sheet. Someone there lies, the truth is not zero. A lot of factors that go into a lot of assumptions. There's discount rates, life expectancy tables. I know you opened up an OPEB trust. You put $100,000 in it, I believe. And that's sitting out back in your financial statements. That's that trust fund. The whole goal about OPEB is opening up a trust, what you did, and then how you're going to use it in the future. What are you going to build it to? You have a plan, I think, as a committee, you should start establishing a plan. for that fund. You know, either build it up to, say, $10 million, and then once it hits $10 million, you're going to pay retirees' costs out of there. That's kind of the general gist of these financial statements, just, I don't know if you have any exact questions on this.
Can I ask a question about the OPEB obligations?
Yeah.
Just statewide, do you have any idea what they, I mean, if we're at $5 million, we're tiny. What are these just numbers, just in the billions statewide?
Yeah, we have one of our cities at $500 million. I mean, there's no way they're going to be able to fund that.
So if we're not going to be, I mean, if you had a crystal ball, would you foresee that the state is going to, or that some entity is going to come in and do something about this rather than leaving it all up to the municipalities to fund this impossible to fund dilemma?
I wouldn't pay attention to the 5.9. I would more pay attention in theory. I mean, the cost does exist. For instance, a superintendent or an example, anyone that's in the retirement system that's leaving. So one position can cost 3 health insurances. So if someone retires and you backfill it, that's another health insurance going to come on. So it's going to grow. So it's how you approach it. Like putting it into an OPEB trust and, like I said, have marks for it. Wait, you know, we're going to build up to $5 million, then we're going to proportion the cost. Are you paying right now out of your general fund budget? You're going to move it over to that trust. So it's more of how you're going to use the trust and how it's going to impact your future budgets.
And there's plenty of schools right now that are not able, that see themselves as unable to fund these obligations at all, right?
Correct.
And so is this going to be a situation in the future where the responsible districts that try to do something about it are going to be penalized when the cavalry rides to the rescue?
I don't think so. I mean, it's because it's still going to be a cost on your books. You're still going to have retirees' health costs on your books. They're not going to go away unless you have a big termination rate or expiration date. Well, yeah, as you get older, you know, you're going to leave this computer. That's going to be a cost that's going off your book, so that's the only way your retiree's health costs are going to go down or not replace backfill positions.
But, what we wrestle with, if somebody's going to come to the rescue about this, is it the prudent thing to do to continue to fund this, to really do as best we can to fund this, even though it's such a sacrifice to do it?
I think it's basically the OPEB trust is like another reserve, sort of like E&D or stabilization fund. At some point, you're going to tap into that. And when you tap into it, you're going to reduce your overall operating budget, which is then you're going to reduce your overall assessments to the communities.
Nobody's coming to the rescue. Don't worry about it. Not those kind of numbers.
Like you say,
this is just us. And we're just a little dot out here in the middle of no place.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about the $5.9 million. You know, it seems when I'm talking to bond rating companies that they're not worrying about the larger number, that's just how you're dealing with it. Because your retiree costs are going to grow unless you don't backfill positions or you have deaths. There's only two ways to reduce that number. So that's kind of the whole theory behind it. That's what I'm telling most of our clients, is don't pay attention to the large number. You're never going to get there. And if you did start materially funding it, let's say you start putting $500,000 into it, you would see this number drop because you can use a different discount rate. So there's a lot of assumptions involved in that number. That's why when I say $5.9 million, I don't think that's the real number, but zero isn't a real number either, somewhere in between. It's really just a theory of how you're going to fund this, put money into a trust.
So there's a dozen other places we can spend $500,000 first before we put it in there.
So it's really long-term thinking. You're thinking fiscal years 2027, 25. You know, how to reduce your assessment to that point, but you can have it as a funding. Those are the two statements. I think you're an accountant, you probably get more into it. It's your average person, but don't really get into these. On pages 14 and 15, these are ones management you should probably pay particular attention to. This is kind of traditional. It has, you know, no depreciation, it's cash in, cash out. One of the key numbers to pay attention to is under the general fund unassigned, the $350,202. That should represent your E&D, I believe it is. I believe
it has. It should be certified by Friday.
I thought it was already certified, but
No, they're backed up. They did the towns first because they needed to get their assessments out.
So your E&D should be right at mark 350. You could have some reductions in it by timing of grants and payments or timing of receipts, which should be in the ballpark of 350, which you're under the 5% to carry over. How that E&D is generated, if you turn to page 18. And this is another key financial statement when you look at it, as far as management goes looking. You'll see on your for the last column all the way out, that's how you compare to your budget. So you estimated revenues of $10 million and you took in $10,228,000 over, took in revenues over what you budgeted, $173,000. The two drivers on that is Medicaid, about $90,000 of that money, and then the excess transportation of approximately about $54,000. You then took that $54,000 and you moved it to a transportation revolving fund. And that's the negative under transfers out, so you didn't have a budget for it. So those two kind of offset one another. So really on your revenues, you're picking up, you're not budgeting Medicaid, which is a very smart thing to do. It's helping you generate E&D. And then you had turned back appropriations about $219,000. Those two factors which drive in your E&D is really turnbacks and your Medicaid money. So if you keep that in mind setting future budgets. Again, you're under your 5%, roughly your budget's about just over 10 million, so you're allowed to carry just over 500,000 in E&D. What I tell all of our regional school districts that we audit is someone's got to have the reserves. If you get out there on the bond market or if you get out there just for things come up, projects come up, is either the town's going to have the reserves or the regional school is going to have the reserves. I know on your school choice fund, you're using it as you get it in, which is okay. But just keep in mind that the two primary reserves in a regional school is school choice and E&D. A healthy reserve is right around 5%. So if you put school choice and E&D together, you should be in that ballpark of it. Those are your, kind of your key on your financial statements. Really, that budget versus actual is really good to look at and the drivers of it. So that's kind of on the financial end of it. If you have any questions at any time, if anyone reads any questions, they can get a hold of the man. The next document is the management letter. And again, the whole purpose of a management letter as we go through when we design our audit procedures, there's 13 items that come to our attention where you can improve operating efficiencies. Some of the key things to pay attention to in a management letter is there's kind of comments in there that put the three buckets, the material weaknesses and significant deficiencies. I think those two names kind of speak for themselves. For instance, if you weren't tracking your budget, if you weren't tracking expenditures, if you weren't balancing your cash, you weren't doing your departmental reconciliations, those type of things that would be in those categories. So you have to deal with them kind of in a timely manner. You don't have any of those categories, which is good. You just have other matters, which is basically we're trying to more operating efficiency. Some things we see in your financial statements compared to other regional schools. Kind of some things are nitpicky, some things aren't. The first one we had kind of went through is the Union 30 agency account. At the end of fiscal year 2016, we had a balance of about $66,000. The agency fund's not designed to accumulate a surplus. You can see that the fund balance is broken down between encumbered and unassigned. So the encumbrance is approximately $65,000. Usually, when you're in that union, that agency, you should be clearing out what you bill should be taken in. I know we talked to Patty during our audit, and she had a pretty good plan going forward to resolve the issue, is to get it to a quarterly billing type actual.
Yes.
So again, this is something you should be monitoring kind of going forward. It should be zeroing out when you look at the reports, especially the year-end one that gets distributed. You should be this one you should look at, see what's that Union 38 should be clearing out to zero. It shouldn't be accumulating a surplus. Questions on that? Number two, since you're a single audit, I'm not too sure what coastal is. I have a hard time getting my hands around it. Never mind. Fast best seems to be the hot term right now. Is all your internal controls need to be documented in accordance with the Green Book, which is the federal government internal controls being documented for the coastal framework. The general thumb is, down to is, you just gotta have common sense and document. You have controls in place. You have a warrant signing process that you sign off on every month. It's tied back to the check registers, which lead to bank accounts. But since you're in, you're getting awards from federal government. The federal government passed a new guidance this year, and this is coming right out of that. That any granting awarding agencies need to have their internal controls documented. Going forward, I don't know how much of an impact. I know it's going to be an administrative burden on all of our clients, the feedback we've been getting. But we just want to remind you and kind of bring it to your attention that your controls need to be documented. You do have controls. Kind of go back and forth. I try to use a common sense approach to things. Is just because you have your document, are you following them? I don't think the sole purpose was just to get a book out and put it on the shelf and let it collect dust. So I kind of use that when you're going. I mean, it more falls on to Patty and her group of getting it documented. You may see this in here for a couple of years until it does get documented. That's kind of the general meaning on that. Questions on that? I know I usually get a lot of questions on that from other groups. Exactly what this is. It's basically just documenting internal controls.
Tom, say that again. I didn't hear that. Documenting your what?
Internal controls.
Okay.
Like, you know, you're balancing your cash, or you're doing gate receipts and collecting like rent, you're compliant with Chapter 30B procurement. You are doing that, you do have procedures not documented.
So we're doing it, it's just not where we can get a hold of it and say, here it is?
Yeah, for instance, we're not seeing too much in school district, but for cities and towns right now that have HUD grants, first question they're coming out and asking is, let me see your policies and procedures, your documentation manual. Most communities are saying, well, we don't have it, but I can tell you what we do, and they're like, no, you're not getting the award. So we're seeing more on the HUD end and really a public safety grants. So it hasn't trickled that way down to school grants yet, but the fear is there.
They're coming.
Yeah, it's kind of stay ahead of the barking dogs, you know.
Is this for grants specifically?
Yes.
Or for everything we do?
Because you account for your grants within your accounting system, so it's for grants, but since the grants are accountable within your accounting system, you have to document all your controls around your accounting system.
So is it fair to say because we get grants, we have to document for the entire procedure?
Correct, yeah. But you know, we're just Massachusetts, we're kind of unique. When you get out west, there are certain school districts that will run federal grants outside their accounting system. They'll have a separate bank account set up by the superintendent and run it. So Massachusetts is a little unique where they have a lot of structure to their accounting systems. And everything goes through Mass DESE and passed down through. Number three is just, you know, as we talked about OPEB standards, Jason, changing, you're going to see even a bigger number on your balance sheet. Right now, you're amortizing that liability over 30 years, and now they're going to say you can't do that anymore. They're going to put it on your financial statements. Again, it's more, right now, your OPEB study, we're having that done. They're going to take that into account, but you're going to see that $5.9 million probably grow to about $20 million in a matter of a year.
Impressive.
That's what I'm saying. Don't pay too much attention to standards. But you still have to do it because you're getting a clean opinion and you want to stay with that clean opinion. So I just want to give that heads up. That's kind of, number four, we have some other matters. Some of the things we've looked at your financial statements, they're a lot of analytical. And what we do all our testing around your treasury. So making sure your cash is balanced, your assessments are billed properly, they all come in, they're all recorded in your financial, because that's your biggest risk when you look at your financials. I kind of went into your, I call it your secondary tier, your outlier receipts. In our analytics, we pulled out two departments, school lunch. Your school lunch receipts dropped pretty significantly. And a number of meals served dropped pretty significantly. So we went and looked at school lunch, and we walked through a whole month of from your POS systems to the bank, and we found no issues with them. You're making your deposits on time. You have very adequate controls regarding school lunch. It was just a matter of your school lunches dropped. We are seeing that kind of a trend across most of our clients, that we are seeing the school lunches drop. I'm not too sure why. It is something you should keep your eye on rolling through 17. But the bottom line is your controls were there as far as cash getting to the bank, pretty consistent on deposits. We're pretty pleased on that aspect. The other department we picked was athletic revolving, kind of to your next tier out in your non-major fund, your special revenue fund. Your gate receipts, you have very excellent reporting in that. You do print number tickets, match them up. Again, we took September, October, November 2016. All the money hit the bank that was supposed to, and they're made within a 1 to 2 day deposit. We have very adequate controls over your gate receipts. Then the second receipt that goes into athletic revolving is athletic fee. If you play sports, you get billed. A little archaic, the system, compared to other schools. The rosters come from the coaches, which are all logged, comes into the central office, and then that's what's used to maintain the outstanding list. So if you want to see who's unpaid at a given time, you have to go through these manual rosters. You may want to think about implementing an integrated billing system.
We will be doing that with PowerSchool.
Okay.
We just implemented PowerSchool, and we've been trying to get our other areas up and running, but the IT director has already reached out to me to work with the person in the principal's office who does the billing and get that billing up and going.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, it's just, it was, you know, our testing, you know, and then, you know, we did a lot of analytical there, and cash was getting to the bank, so we're very pleased on that. If you want to be more efficient, you probably put that billing, but it sounds like you are. So those got kind of the two departments we did, and we were satisfied with the controls you have in place. And let's see, for as prior year's findings go, the one I really want to talk about is authorization of the warrants. Right now, school committee's signing those after all the checks are going out. And that is a control in place that those bills are proper, and that's why you're signing them. We'd like to see you form a subcommittee and do that beforehand. When it comes to the actual school committee assigned, kind of goes through the motions. There's a lot of complications with that, with the new Modernization Act, the way I interpreted it and the way other people interpreted it. And I know they're trying to get this all cleaned up for springtime at the MASBO meeting. So I would kind of hold off into formalizing that process until that comes out, which will probably happen going into the next school year by the time that interpretation comes out in the spring. We just want to understand just the risk behind it. Where we're coming from is we're relying on that control as far as expenditures are being proper. So when we're designing our tests, we're looking at your, do you take your total number of warrants? We're pulling a sample out of there. And if we see all the warrants are signed, that's reducing our risk. And if they're tied to the check registers, that reduce our risk anymore, that the expenditure is going to be proper. It just, you're signing it after the fact, so there's that little risk there that something could get out the door if it's improper. So I think it's small, but from our perspective and communicating to you, you do have a little bit of deficiency there. But understand you don't have to do something next week on it. As soon as it gets cleared up, interpretations about the open meeting that people constitute. Hopefully I'll be clear up in the springtime, but that's kind of where we're coming from on that regard.
I think we're in the process of doing exactly that, though, of
having
the subcommittee
yeah.
And
yeah.
It was about to start, but then there was a legal something or other.
When the Modernization Act, Tom and I had discussed it, I had called him, and we both agreed that would be our best bet. And then subsequently, we found out that it was for cities and towns only, regionals, the law. I don't think they intended to leave out the regionals,
no.
But they did. So it has to be amended to, so for it to be applicable to regionals, and that's why Tom's saying, we said March, Cindy, and that's what he's saying, springtime, we should have a resolution to that.
At this point, yeah, I think they're shooting for like late March, early April to kind of get that resolution out. I know we've had several scooters before, like 3 or 4 years ago, I implemented that three-person subcommittee, and it's been interpreted they're a violation of the open meeting law now after they've been doing it for years, so there's some complications that came out of it, and like I said, they left the regional schools out of that new act. I don't think was the intention, so.
So that's the reason for your third paragraph down there?
Yeah.
For status?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, knew you were going to do your intention, I talked to Patty.
So you understand we have been working on it?
Yeah, yeah. It's more from our perspective, like, then I just want to communicate what the risk is by you not doing it. You're just mm-hmm. signing the bills after the fact. Mm-hmm. Which that's kind of my presentation. Unless there's specific questions, funny. Like I said, I mean, I think it's a compared to the way about 80 municipal clients that we go out to. You know, you're right up there as far as recording and sound control. So.
Anybody have any questions? I would just like to recognize Patty and her whole department, the accounting bookkeepers that we have work diligently, and it certainly is reflected tonight, so thank you.
Nice job, Patty.
And thank you, Tom, for making this so understandable.
And let me, can I just say that this is our second audit with Scanlon, and that we had a longtime auditor, and so this was relatively still a new audit for us, and the process switching over to Scanlon Associates couldn't have been more seamless. His staff are, they blend right in, they're very easy to work with, they're good, they ask good questions, and Tom is very responsive whenever I have an issue, not during or audit time. He's always makes himself available, and I just want to show my appreciation for Tom and his staff.
Like we broke the wall, right? Did we break the wall this year? Doug fell into the wall?
Yeah, we broke. Right before we moved out, one of the poor auditors went to push the seat back in the old kitchen, and it got, I shouldn't laugh, it got caught, and he fell and put a hole in the drywall. He comes in my office, and he's like, I'm so sorry, I broke your wall. It's like, it's all right, we're moving. So if you do that in the new place, though, we're going to charge you. Yeah.
Cinder block.
Thank you for coming out tonight.
Oh, yeah, no problem. Yeah, if you have any questions anytime, don't state calling him, just don't. Just a simple question about, I don't know, your laws or acts or budget questions.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to reviewing and approving the minutes of December 13, 2016. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
I'll second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all those ready to vote? In favor, raise your hand. Accepting, oppose, and abstain. Anybody? Just you?
Just me.
Just you. Just Lynn.
Yep.
Okay, financial statements.
Okay, first off, I want to apologize because I thought I emailed this to you on January 9th when I sent out the warrants for you to review. And when I went tonight to pull up my copy of what I thought I sent you, I realized I had never emailed it, so I apologize. I brought copies for you this evening. There are warrants here for you to sign that total $1,734,884.08. Those are the warrants that I sent you in the email, plus the payroll warrants. So I do need signatures in this purple folder before we all disperse this evening. And I think that's all I have for the financial statement, unless anybody has any questions.
Any questions or comments?
We got some large overages. I think we probably talked about some of them before.
What page, Mr. Becker?
Page one. 165% over on the particular account. About the fourth or fifth one up.
Yep, that's our district-wide admin contracted services, and I think this was just a budgeting error. When we, our new IT director got here, Scott Paul, he spent his first term getting all our inventory done and all our hardwares. And then this past year, he and I have been focusing on identifying all the softwares in the district because there were no reason to budget for them. So we finally have a comprehensive schedule of softwares. So some of these, you're gonna see even in next year, we're still making adjustments as to, so first we identified them. Now this year, we're trying to classify them properly because there's different, we have district-wide software that would include the Power School, our eSped, the service that does our robocalls, ASOP. Those are all things we use at the district level. Then we have instructional technology, which is what the software the kids use in the classroom. We also have softwares that we test with, and that's in the 2720 testing assessment softwares. Then we have another set of softwares that run the building, like our Microsoft licenses and things like that. So the lines may be out of whack, but in totality, I think the only thing that we identified this year that we didn't budget for was our virtual high school.
Next page, fourth line down, the second section, stipends, other services. What?
What? You're on page two.
Yep. I think it's stipends.
What is it? I'm
stipends, sorry. Other services.
Other services.
Page
two. For the minus 118%.
Okay.
I just focused on
the negative. This is the way to find it.
Okay, that's the principal's office, and that would be summer work or translating work. That's what we're budgeting there. I'll take a look and see what got charged.
And that's something that's been done and been paid and not likely to get any bigger.
Correct, because, unless the principal needs something else translated between now and the end of the year.
So you're saying it's translation services?
That's what where your budget and translation services and if you hire summer help in the office.
Okay. And where are you taking them from?
Well, I mean, I don't want to disagree pay on anything, but I don't understand like how my salary is overdrawn. We knew what my salary was before. Why is there an excess in my salary? And there's an excess in the assistant principal's salary, an excess in the stipends, other services. And so I'm wondering why it's saying we have excess in salary lines and we know the budget lines for those. And so that's why I'm confused.
Could be something in the encumbrance that I've got 1 week. Because I run these like to the year, if she's already run the January payroll when I'm running this, our encumbrance could be off.
Okay, I see a lot of salaries. I don't know, I haven't done any different spending patterns than I've done in the past. There has been more translations, because we've had more students of different backgrounds coming into our school where we need to do translations. That could be, but it's only a few hundred bucks. So I don't know, for each one. So maybe around $600-$700 as I remember it, but we can go back and take a look at what that is.
The next one down, Patty, is salaries and industrial arts. Looks like you're almost $23,000 to the negative.
Okay, so again, what I'm going to, one of the things that has not been adjusted yet, and I will check this out because I'm sure somewhere else I'm 23 the other way.
That's probably true,
But what happens is that when we do the budget now, like we're doing, we plan on, I believe industrial arts was still a 1.5 position, and then during the budget process, we hit a 0.5 out of there because we decided we hired someone else. So the industrial arts, which we budgeted at 1.5, but really is a 1, I've adjusted the budget to the 1, but the payroll person may not have adjusted. Whoever replaced that person, they're still charging the line item there. So I have to go through and check her codings. And that I guarantee you that's what it is. The person who replaced a retired teacher who was a 0.5 here and a 0.5 in health But the person that we hired is actually doing 0.5 health and 0.5 science. And I guarantee you, she's being charged to the old setup, the old account setup. So I have to go through each of these lines and check them.
I was exhausted just listening to that explanation.
Sorry.
Can I make a suggestion? Probably next time when Mr. Decker finds these out, maybe you'll be able to see those negatives and say, just like you just said, and make it easier on yourself. I mean, it's tough.
Well, if you look, science teachers are over 29,000. It looks like we have a savings of 29,683. So I guarantee
that's
you,
fine.
It's right
I'm
there.
I'm only concerned about the negatives.
Right.
Because that raises
well,
the red flag.
But the positives and the negatives make it zero.
Negatives raise the red flag. On page 4, you've got a 575% negative.
And if I could say, I think we actually talked about that in the last meeting, that there was...
That's the virtual high school.
The virtual high school, I remember talking about that. So maybe actually the next time, even if it's just like on the front of this, of bulleted, one, you know, 4 or 5 things bulleted, you're going to see... This is negative this, and because of this, because we're still working on this.
Especially for you, Mr. Decker.
I feel like
just
we've
a one-line explanation.
Time,
probably
we
get
know
here.
That you're working on.
I'll
don't have any other questions.
I'll do that.
Thanks.
You good?
Yeah.
Is everybody else good?
Yeah. Wonderful.
Okay. Public comment? None. Reports. Student Advisory Council.
Ms. Pierce here tonight.
I am. Well. Just last month, we did a Dickin Animal Supplies drive, so we filled about 4.5 of those like printer paper boxes and sent those off. And now we're starting to plan a early spring Spirit Week, and we are planning on doing a field day later in the spring. We've done them every year, but yeah, that's what we're starting right now.
Excellent. Can you tell me?
That's it.
So you're in the planning process.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anybody have any questions? Okay. Thank you very much for coming down tonight.
Thanks.
Unfinished business, long-range facility plans, the Frontier Library media, and the net metering credit. I'm not sure who wants to take that, but it's not me.
I can speak a little bit to actually all of the long-range facilities plan. We had talked about, and it's in your packet, these are things that we were looking for. I'm not sure if the budget committee, I don't know, remind me if we made any warrants on this. I don't believe so. But we did have a long discussion about the Library Media Center envelope, and we talked about continuing our discussion, if we hire someone to come and look at it, to tell us what exactly we're looking at. If we're looking at, the windows, the heating, the ventilation system, the insulation, the structure, how would we go about applying for accelerated
repair
project, or is it something we could do without going that way? Can we fit it in the budget? Can we find other sourcing? We spent a long time, about an hour and 10-15 minutes discussing it in the budget subcommittee, and what came out of that was that we would actually get some people in here to really look at what's going on, to provide some kind of estimate of what it is we're really looking at and how much it would cost, so we would have a better handle on what we need. We're just not sure what we need. We know the roof leaks, we know the window glazing is not okay, we know the insulation is worthless, we're wasting energy. We also, again, are under the, stress. We have this great gift that was donated to our Library Media Center to upgrade the facility, but we really, it wouldn't be astute of us to invest that kind of money knowing that our roof is not in order. So So the goal right now is to just get some preliminary information and bring it back and figure out where we're going to go with it. As far as the net metering credit, we're still on the fence with that, and because tonight was so involved with the budget and with Mr. Scanlon coming, we decided that we would put off that discussion and that guest speaker until next month to make sure we're interested.
So we're going to table C.
We're tabling C. B, we did have some movement on that.
Okay.
And we are going to try and get an estimate at little to no cost to us, but get someone up there to really look at what's going on. We just don't really have a handle on it. And so those are the things that...
Did the roof leak yesterday, today?
Yeah, really.
I know, school was closed today.
Did it leak?
You really good there, then?
Yeah. I just remember the night I interviewed for my job, and it was awful. It was raining. Yeah, buckets.
It didn't rain that hard. I think it's the wind driven rain against the glass upstairs that starts the problem.
Not necessarily the glass.
Okay, so
because there's really
long range facilities planned. You want to vote to approve it?
No, you got to vote to approve somebody coming in and just take a look see.
Right, the envelope, but the long range facility plan is
A on your list. So are we still in discussion on that?
We are.
Okay.
Well, I think we are because part of it has design study and LMC in there too.
Yeah.
Okay, so
yeah,
I just wanted
tied together.
So just to, we are not taking a vote on anything tonight for unfinished business.
That's correct.
So what you're reporting is that everything is still on the table, even though we're tabling it for tonight, but that you're still working on it and you are making movement.
We are making movement. Several of these items involve looking at that, and again, rather than hire an architect, if we need to hire someone to come and look at it, we're hoping to keep it $5,000 and under.
Okay.
We're not talking about $25,000 to get an architect in here to build a new design.
Okay. We could take a vote on
so
B if that
vote.
Makes everybody more comfortable with
it. It does.
That's what Bob was just saying about voting to approve to go looking for some help.
For clarification of the subcommittee, you guys had talked about the fact whether or not we go to the state to go to the building commission for to look at this. However, once you're in there, you have to use their people and their process going through. And we said, well, we don't really understand the full scope of the project. We wanted to bring somebody in, you know, for me up to $5,000 within getting the different kind of scopes between the windows, the roof, the insulation, and the overall structure and what could be done to get more information to bring back to the committee to make this decision. That was how I understood where it was lying.
Yeah.
Does that sound about right?
That's exactly right.
But was it 5 to 15 or something?
5 to 15,000, depending on, well, there was, should we get a roof guy? Should we get an insulation guy? So I think what we finally decided is that we would get a designer or an architect that specializes in roof, windows, doors, and have him come in and give us a scope of service. And that could cost up to $15,000 to have it, because it's going to be an architect and they don't do anything for free.
Probably going to be more than that.
Well, that's for plans, that's not for the general.
My understanding was we were going to get right away an architect. We were going to look at what the damage is or what the needs are.
But that's who would do it. So
it's more than what Bob. So it's more than what Bob can do.
Correct.
As an assessment, unless you bring in contractors for each part of that job to give you an estimate.
That's exactly what it is. And Bob's going to obviously try to shoot as low as possible, but he always estimates high.
You got an email everybody did today on the Massachusetts School Building Authority training start of the building. This is something next week.
Mm-hmm.
They're supposed to tell you about all this stuff.
The process.
Yeah, and just so you're aware of it.
Are you going?
I don't know. I might go if you're driving.
Only if it's Tuesday.
I actually was just going to make this a similar recommendation, but while we were at the conference, there were several contractors that specialize in buildings that are probably less expensive than hiring an architect.
My understanding was we were going to start there.
so.
I might be misusing the word architect, okay, but someone, like, I don't know if it's a structural engineer, I don't know who it is that does it, but someone who's specializing in, is in assessing roofs, windows, and doors to tell us what the bulk of the problem is.
Okay, so.
Cindy.
I'm sorry.
If you're going to do any work on a roof, you're going to have to hire a structural engineer because it's over 35,000 cubic feet. State regulations require you to have a stamp seal on it to get a building permit.
So I'm going to rely on Bob to, them to take care of that.
Yeah.
As what I, what I'm looking for is, how much money do you want to be attached to B? It says to approve the solicitation of proposals for repairs to the library media center roof slash envelope. So I need a number here that
not to
either.
Exceed 10,000.
Not, and where would it now, people from? Were saying 5 and 15, but, and then again, where is it
we're
coming from?
We're not talking about the entire roof, we're only talking about
fixing the leaks.
This piece right there.
Or an evaluation of what.
Right, and that's what we're looking at.
Think 10's enough, or do you want more?
I believe Bob asked for 15, and he was being very conservative.
All right, so.
I don't know, he's being very. He's not going to spend anywhere near that much.
No.
Not too much.
Conservatives are the most mixed up.
Modesto, M-O-D.
I know, I know. get a headshot of that man over there.
Where are you approving this money from?
Oh, we got all these surpluses here. I saw one here. I think the principal brought up.
Okay, bringing it back around. Well, what I wanted to establish first is how much do we think it will cost? So he is saying that 15 is way too much, but he would like that.
That's the number he gave us at the subcommittee meeting, for us to reduce it here without him here to counter and saying
okay,
it. But
so
he was talking about it being much lower, but that was just the general number that was talked about. As I'm asking the subcommittee, that they remember.
That's what I remember.
Yeah.
If we make a motion with 15 in it, so now we need to know where we're going to get that money before we make that motion, Bob.
But we're talking $15,000. Are we talking $15,000 just for this little roof area here that we need as a roof specialist? Or are we talking $15,000 to do this, windows, insulation?
Yes.
They're all inextricably tied together because the only way you're going to, like the HVAC equipment, the only way you're going to get it in there is through those windows. So you're not going to put in brand new windows and then take them out to change the HVAC equipment. You take the windows out. Change your, they're all tied together, so we need three. You may need one guy, two guys, three
Well, this
guys.
Thing needs to, I know it says roof here, but it needs to be.
It says envelope.
I know.
Yeah. Right. The three things are, it's the HVAC, you can hear it. The only way, as Bill was saying, the only way it can come in is through those windows
they're
right there. Or they take a wall out.
So it's the HVAC,
they could do that.
The
insulation.
And then the insulation. So there's three, or is there one person that can do them all? That's Bob's job to find out what that scope
is. That's what we didn't know as subcommittee members, whether it's one person, two person, or three people
right.
we need to talk to, or one person can do all this.
And it may not cost
advice.
Anything.
So that's
that was one thing we
and
talked
that,
about.
And that is a possibility.
Well, we don't know, Bob. That's the trouble. That's the problem we were having as a subcommittee. We don't know yet. We don't know what, because a lot of this, if you spend too much money on this, and then you go to the accelerated repair program, the state is going to redo what you just did.
That is correct.
So you have to be careful not wasting your time. Because the accelerated repair program requires you to use their, who they tell you you're going to use. Doesn't make a difference what you've done up to that point. You can't say to them, this is what we need to do. No, they'll tell you what you're going to do. That's why it's an accelerated program. So we're trying to get this done as cheaply as possible, but have enough information so you can at least make an intelligent assessment of what the hell you're trying to do.
And an intelligent request.
Right.
So
needed. It's so needed.
If these financial statements are right, coverage
is
flogged in properly, right? It looks like you're going to end up with a surplus in tuition, non-public schools, of about $100,000. So if you probably find your 15 there, because it's already had encumbrances of 292 or 293 roughly provided for. So if everything's been identified and encumbered properly, chances are you have money available in that account.
In the tuition fund?
Excuse me? Yeah.
So it's the tuition fund?
It's the second account up on the last page. mean, if you know what I think we ought to do, I think we ought to vote on a not to exceed 15 with a recommendation before it's coming from the business manager. Well, that's not the right title.
Director
of Business Services on where the which line item the funding should come from.
Somebody say so moved.
So moved.
Thank you.
Fine.
Somebody second that.
You're sitting here all night looking at those goddamn numbers.
Anybody got any other? Did you get who seconded it? It was Lynn.
Lynn was second.
Oh, I'm sorry. It was Judy.
Judy.
No, I'm sorry.
Can do, Patty?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Easy.
So you could have come up with that 5 minutes ago.
Yeah, it's true.
I was asleep.
Okay, is everybody comfortable with that?
No,
not at all. All those in favor? Yes. Okay, moving along.
See how easy that was?
So I want you to keep that whole attitude. No, attitude. For the presentation of the budget. Nice
okay.
And calm, to the point.
I got it. No problem. In front of you, you will see the documents they put together. It says budgetary and assessment information. Got it? We've had a couple, I don't know, two or three meetings so far at the budget subcommittee. And it's kind of a little bit different process this year. We're stretching it out on purpose, trying to give more time for you guys to be able to look at what we've been looking at rather than us. We didn't want to walk in here and hand you something. Can you vote on this tonight? That's exactly what we didn't want to do. We wanted to give you this document tonight. There's no assessment information here because we don't have any yet. This is budget information only. No assessment information, no cost to the towns. Budget information only as it pertains to you guys. And what we thought we would do is it would give you, we're scheduled to meet 2 weeks from tonight and again 2 weeks after that. So what we're hoping we can do is if there are questions, if there are problems with what's in this document, you guys will have 2 weeks to look at it. And then we can go through those questions in February on the 7th. If everybody's comfortable at that point, you can take your vote, which you have to take in February. If you're not comfortable with it, that's why we scheduled one for the 28th. So you can tell this budget subcommittee I'm not comfortable with X, Y, and Z. Please go back and look. So we have time to go back and look so we don't just keep handing you things and asking you to vote on them the night we hand them to you. That makes no sense. The thought process that's completely restricts the thought process. That's the way I looked at it this year. That's why everything is stretching out a little bit more. Patty will go through the highlights and the lowlights in this thing, and we're not asking for any action on it tonight. We want you to take it home, and if you have problems, questions, difficulties with it, call Patty's office, get a hold of whoever in your town is on the budget subcommittee, and see if we can, you know, so when you come in next time, in 2 weeks, we already know your question, and we'll have you answer, so we don't keep kicking the can down the road.
Who's on the subcommittee?
One. Two.
And
Keith. And I'm missing somebody.
Mary.
Yeah, hello, Mary.
I said the lineup right there.
Yep. Yeah, murderer's row plus me. So that's where that's kind of the process we were going. Let Patty do her thing with this and see where we go from there.
All right. So the first page is just our cover page, and even though it says assessment, as Mr. Smith said, we do not have our assessment information. I believe the governor's budget is due to be released tomorrow. And Desi is saying that they will have our Chapter 70 estimates up as quickly as possible after the release. Our second page is just who is on the committee that is going through this budget process. And then the third page is our first numbered page. And if you will notice, I have up in the corner of every page that this is version one, and we have 21 pages to review, and this is today's date. The day that we review it, and then we're just, in case there's a lot of changes, we're just going to keep this going. So this first page is a new page that Dr. Carey brought with her, and I absolutely love it. We're calling it the student and staff data sheet. And on the at the first section, Mr. Modesto has identified goals from his school improvement plan, which what we're trying to accomplish with these budgetary dollars. On the left, we have our enrollment as of the October 1st census, and we're going to use that date because that is what our foundation enrollment when we get our Chapter 70 money is based on. So right now, this past October, we had 611 students, and 120 of them were on IEPs.
So to do next year's enrollment, we just took the 7th through the 11th and moved them forward to the 8th through the 12th grade. In grade 7, I'm going to let Darius speak to you a little bit about this. Right now in the elementary schools, we have 146 sixth graders. 34 of them are on IEPs, and it's hard to pin this number down because we don't know how many are school choice that will return to their own district for high school. We don't know how many will not come here choosing Frontier Regional, and that presents its problems.
Right. I've mentioned it in previous meetings, the average, for instance, last year's class, I think, was 132, and we are at 120-ish for the 7th grade.
106.
That doesn't include special ed programs as well. So our FTAP and life skills is not that number, correct?
I believe it is. I took that off the census data that we uploaded to the state.
It says the sped enrollment numbers are included in the total.
Okay.
So you don't add them together. It's 106.
All right. So I'm running off my memory of what last year's number was, but it's high. I believe it was high 20s, and we lose between 10 and 15, sometimes even 10 and 20 students between private schools, charter schools, returning to choiced in schools. I mean, they went to our elementary schools and they want to go back for secondary. And so that kind of range has gone from year to year, and I don't have that. I probably can dig through my notes. I'm going to be able to find that for you and point that out. But so we lose about that much between each year. This year is an exceptionally large class coming in from the sixth grade. So I don't know if we're going to run with the average number of students who are leaving, or does that average go up because there's more students? I don't know, because, you know what I mean, it's one of those, you understand what I'm saying? If we still lose about 10, you take 10 from 46, we're going to have a much larger class. Or because we have more students, there's going to be more people choosing to go elsewhere. Again, I don't know where that's going to be. We're, you know, part of my presentation, we're about to do the transition process with coming to Frontier and you know, visiting and doing the coffees with me and that kind of stuff. And usually we can get a feel because people start talking to their principals back in their elementary schools about whether or not they're attending Frontier or not on the following year, so we can get a preliminary report. But they really do have the choice right up until the end of the school year. Usually private schools are a little bit earlier. They're, I believe, early April is when they make their decisions. And then the other ones are later. So this particular class is tricky because if we get a lot of them, it's going to, as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to have to change the staffing in the middle school. And that was part of our, talk about that as part of the budget process moving forward, when we get to that rather. And I would have to take people from the high school to cover because it's a one-year blip. The year following that does not have, the class is not as large. It's still a larger class, but not as large as this class. So it gets tricky because right now the class sizes in the middle school are right in the low 20s, 22 to 24. And if we get a large class like that, you're talking about, you know, 27 to 30, while workable, that's not the optimal class size that I would recommend. I mean, you can come back and see what we want to do with, but I wouldn't recommend class sizes that large for middle school. So that being said, we're kind of waiting and seeing on some of that. Is there anything I'm missing there, Patty, from what we talked about?
I just looked up for you what the sixth grade enrollment was in May. Was 132, and we got 106, and right now we're down to 105.
Okay.
This is things in the packet. Grade 6 had 145 in the elementary school right now in grade 6, which would be the 7th grade in this budget. But it says 145 on the sheet that's in your packet.
Yeah. Right, and in here, the one down below, it says 146, so they increased by one. Somebody must have moved into the district since.
The other thing is, we lost one.
This is as of October 1st.
The other thing is you've got 26 kids, students, that are school choice. They're coming in, if I read this choice in, males 13, females 13 right now. So I don't know what the ratio is between the school choice kids in the sixth grade. And whether or not that goes down at all. What's that?
You were wandering off to a different page up by your lonesome.
Well, no, he's
get it right off this thing here.
He's just on the regular packet that you get.
He's not talking about your packet. He's talking about the packet you get on email.
So I didn't hear, I didn't understand the question.
I'm saying you got, in the current seventh grade, right, you have 26 choice in.
This year.
Right, of the 106 kids, 26 are choice in. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the ratio is of the current sixth grade as to how many of those students are choice in.
35.
How many?
35.
35, so.
35 of the 146 are on the school choice program.
Yeah. And then again, I don't know what percentage of the choice kids you lost coming to seventh grade last year. So it's got to be a combination of statistics.
And I'll tell you, year after year, we get different kind of runs of different things in the sense of it's, we try to go through and look at it, why everybody chose different schools. Case by case, I talk with the principals as to why they didn't choose Frontier. And you get the full gamut. You know what I mean? Somebody's looking for something different. Somebody's parent works in Northampton, so therefore they want to go that direction. You know, it goes on and on and on, that kind of thing. So,
are there any students that aren't in the elementary in a different district that then choice in the middle school?
Yes, but right now, right now it's about a handful probably each year between seventh and eighth grade.
So it always is a lower number from what you see.
Absolutely, we don't add, our school choice numbers are coming from the elementary schools. It's we add a few, and then we probably lose a few. It's probably, you know, that kind of thing.
So
I have capped it in the past. Like, I capped the eighth grade class. Current eighth grade class, you can see, is larger. I didn't have any other school choice add in at the end there.
So when we get further in this packet, I'm going to pull apart some of those school choice out and in and charter out numbers. And we do have the rosters now, so I'm going to be looking for some assistance to say, here's what my school choice, how many of them did go to Frontier. So we're going to do some further analysis to see if we can help Mr. Modesto come up with a good estimate of how many of these 146 we will get. But as you can see, we would, if we got off 146, we'd go from 600, a population of a 611 to 668, and that's a big jump. So I just put that there as a placeholder, and we're going to be, we won't.
There's going to be some. I mean, kids are private, yeah. You know, the private schools, awesome. That's a transition point.
On the right side of the page, we have our staff by FTEs. So we're looking at last year's budget to this year's budget. And you can see that we're dropping down in this budget 2.1 FTEs. And then on the bottom, we're listing out for you how many of our professional teaching staff are at the different columns of the contract, bachelor's, master's, master's plus 30, and master's 45 CAGs. So that's new data that we've never presented before. So I like this. It gives us a nice little snapshot of our student staff. So I appreciate Dr. Carey bringing this to us because I think it is a very good summation.
Could I just go back there, Darius, just to the extent that you were soliciting an opinion from the school committee about classroom size preferences, could I just say that I'm not real comfortable with just offering an opinion on that, that my preference would be that you all develop your own sense of what the most educationally sound best practice is, and that you tell me what you need so that I can support that.
Are you talking about the size of the classroom?
Yeah, and that.
That was kind of woven in there.
Class sizes generally are connected directly to budget because the number of staff members you're going to think. So when I'm going to be able to try to shift staffing without increasing budget, we're talking about a part of a position that I may have to hire if I have to increase the staff down into middle school. Okay, when we talked originally, and you know, we were originally kind of going through numbers, if I had to make large cuts, the one thing that would happen would be an increase in class sizes. And then that would become a school committee decision because I can only do so much before cutting programs without increasing class sizes. And so I was referring to that. At some point, it does come back to school committee, whether or not we could say we're going to keep class sizes, but we'd have to cut somewhere else. You understand? But class sizes go straight to budget because sizes are based on number of teachers. And so that's where I was inferring that it would then come back to school committee at some point if there was, right now the budget coming in for you is not showing these kind of cuts, but if you countered and said, we want a negative 3% in this year's budget, I would say, okay, you're going to have larger class sizes, because that's the only way
we can do it.
And so that's what I was inferring by saying that.
A lot of work went into it, meetings, Darius, Sarah, myself, Scott, a lot of meetings, Darius working with his, you know, with his team, his leadership team, and how they're going to, it's a domino effect. You know, this here, and then this here, and then this, and then there'll be enough to have these many sections in the middle school. But so far, so okay. So far, so good, so okay. And we think it's doable at this point, but we need to talk more and talk about it.
But we're not going to obtain perfect knowledge before we have to, I mean, we're not going to really know anything more about these issues by the time
but we'll come back. If it impacts student learning and student achievement, we'll be back. We'll be back.
From years past, how soon do you usually get a pretty accurate number of what the enrollment's going to be? I assume it's after
a little bit before that, because we start doing transition meetings in the last few years where we send both special education representatives and the guidance counselors go and meet with each of the sixth grade teachers and talk about the kids coming up. And so they look at needs and placement, and from simple as where their math placement is to things we need to be aware of. And at that time they say, the teachers at that point, again, they have to wait till after the private schools have accepted, but they said, well, this one's leaning, I think a lot of it is gossip and hearsay, I guess you could say, on some of the decisions. I think these parents look, and I know that they were visiting other schools or that kind of thing. Some do wait to come, and I'll talk about that and push that later on, to come to our open house nights and learn a little bit more about Frontier before they make a decision. And so so we do know for within, I would say, five or so, probably by May 1st, would be a guess.
So now we're on page 2 of 21, which is our summary page. And so the FY17 budget was approved at $10,405,86, and that's our starting point. We had an increase in the collective bargaining agreement steps of $69,839. A 2.5% increase was negotiated with the collective bargaining union, and that adds $166,604. We have two new people to longevity, that adds $4,500. A stipend for teaching AP classes was added in this contract, and that's adding $15,960 to our budget. We have for non-union salaries that we don't award until after the budget, we're estimating an increase of $5,633. This budget has the reduction of one instructional assistant at $20,899, a reduction of a 0.6 psychologist for $44,925, and a 0.5 secretary at $13,819. We did have one retirement that we have to do a buyback for. They retired this year, and the buyback will be in the 18 budget. That increases $27,457. And then we have a placeholder here to decrease our budget for positions that we can move to school choice, which would reduce our budget by $150,000, and I'll talk about that in the next couple pages. We do have some other operational increases. Our trash, we're spending about $1,000 over what's been budgeted, so I'd like to increase that. School committee dues, we never budget for our Collaborative for Educational Services membership of $2,900. We just finished our first three-year contract with our legal, and they are, Dr. Carey will be bringing a new contract to the April joint meeting to be approved, which would increase our legal fees by $2,550. The building safety inspections, $8,000. This is money that we right now take out of our maintenance budget, and we would like to have an additional $8,000 appropriation so that our maintenance budget is for repairs and not for annual monthly inspections that we're required to do. So we would like to have that separated out. Increase in instructional software, $11,768. That's the virtual high school. Our Franklin County retirement assessment is increasing $33,639. Our percentage went from 19.88 up to 20.65.
We're with the Franklin County Regional Retirement, and our wages keep growing, and other towns aren't growing in the same way, so our percentage keeps going up. Summer services, we did lose a summer grant that we used to get, so between the loss of that grant and the need for continual summer services for some of our special education students, we need $35,784. Our transportation, it needs to increase $37,992. That's mostly our special education, and we have some medically fragile students who are required to have a nurse travel with them on the bus. So those monitor stipends have never been budgeted, so we need to bring those in. Just to let you know, on our regular transportation, I did this based on a estimate that I thought was going to come in at about 1.6, and I believe it came in at 1.1. I thought it was going to come in at 1.06. It came in at 1.1. So this is going to go up as soon as I download those numbers and reconfigure our contract for next year. I was off 0.4%. That's what you get when you try to guess the labor standards board with federal American governments. Our insurances, $145,601. This is mostly our health insurance. Our two plans are seeing, our HMO plans are seeing a 9.8% increase, and our PPO plans are seeing a 10.4% increase, and the dental has also gone up 8%. We do have some decreases. Superintendent's office, the net effect is a reduction of $2,238. And we do have a decrease in our out-of-district tuitions of $25,487. So to all total, this adds to our budget $311,859, or a 3% increase. And we'll bring our total operating budget to be assessed to the towns to $10,716,945. Does anybody have any questions to this point? Okay, pages 14. It's just the detailed line items with all the changes that I just summarized here for you. So you can take a look at that at your leisure and let me know if you have any questions. As Mr. Smith had said, we're trying to give you guys more time to deliberate this budget. What I've told other school committees is if one person has a question, please email it to me and I will respond to everyone. That if a question was asked, here is the answer. The only thing is, as you all know, in order not to violate open meeting law, we cannot deliberate on those chains of emails. So you just receive information. So if we go to page 15 of 21, I want to talk about school choice for a little bit. So the first column, if you remember last year, was the first year that we had been predicted to not have enough revenue coming in to cover all our outs. So we had to move people into the budget, and we also had to add $69,788 to our budget additionally to make up for that deficit. So we got our preliminary numbers in December, and we're right back upside. So our choice tuition is estimated to be $1,160,540. Our state charter aid, you can see, was a huge jump. They had predicted at budget time we would get $51,504. Right now, we're slated for $197,906. Now, that is the number that most concerns me because it can change downward. And what could affect it going downward? I did speak with Desi last week before we met with our subcommittee meeting. If anyone in the state amends their Schedule 19 on their end of year report, that changes all the foundation tuition amounts. So that could change. Is that likely to have a huge impact? No. But what could have a huge impact is that this money is not safe from any further 9C cuts that Governor Baker might need to make the FY17 state budget balanced. So, and this is an easy target than going after Chapter 78 because there's layers of legislation you have to go to get the Chapter 78. This he could just pick off like that.
Now, according to, you know, my sources, they think that the revenues in this quarter have been picking up as they normally do at this time of year, and there should be no further 9C cuts, but I'm just hesitant on that number. Our outgoing school choice, we are decreased 91,000, and our charter school tuition increased 101. So right now, where we thought we'd be $70,000 in the hole, we're $349,000 to the good. So that is why I am making the recommendation that we could take $150,000 worth of salaries off our budget and move them back onto school choice. So it's not using the entire $349,000, because, and again, that gives us some wiggle room if the charter aid changes. The other recommendation I had made was to leave some in reserve in case A, we get a move-in that could be a high-cost sped child. And two, also, if Mr. Modesto's projections are exceeded in seventh grade and we need more middle school help, that would give us some funding there to add that that teaching position to the middle school as we got closer and our numbers were more concrete. Page 16. Oh, I'm sorry.
When do those numbers become concrete?
In June. When we file our June reports, when we file our June SIMS.
I'm just curious. Something I didn't know.
Yes. Okay. So now this is. I've given you a report here. This is our school choice receiving report, and I've broken it out in detail for you. And this is where I'm going to go. This type of information is where I'm going to go to help Mr. Modesto drill down on a good estimate for what we think our incoming seventh grade. So if you see in June of 16, we had 137 students. Not all of them stayed the full year, so the FTE worked out to 129.17. We had sped increment money of 420,000, tuition of 625,850 for a total of 1,046,172. What we reported in October to the state, we had 148 school choice students. The sped increment was 435,40. The tuition would be 730, so the estimate of 1.16540. Now understand, if any of these 148 do leave, the FTE will change, which will affect our tuition number. It'll be prorated down to the FTE. So where are these children coming from? I've given you a synopsis here, and I see that my page number has run into the total. It does say 148 down there. You can see that the bulk of our students are coming from Greenfield and Montague.
Brand new school didn't have the effect that I thought it might. Apparently not. I wasn't sure with Greenfield having a brand new facility whether that was.
And we're up 8 from the prior year.
Yep.
On the second page, this is the grade levels of our choice students. And just so you know, I didn't compare seventh grade to seventh grade. I compared last year's seventh grade to this year's eighth grade. So you can see we picked up 6 students. So it's not an across, it's sort of like a diagonal math. Because I don't want to compare seventh to seventh, because last year's seventh graders weren't here. This year's seventh graders weren't here. So what I do is I compare the net incoming seventh to the outgoing 12. Does that make sense? So it was a net pickup of 7 students between the 12th graders that left and the seventh graders coming in.
I'm a little confused. If we're doing like a diagonal thing from like 20 to 26, where does the initial 7 come from?
That was what I was just saying. It's the difference between the 12th graders leaving and the 19 children that left in 12th grade and the 26 that came in this year.
Got it.
It's the net effect. It's my balancing factor. All right, so page 18. This is our students that are choicing out. And I'm happy to report that last year in June, there was 58 school choice students going out. This year, there's only 40. And down below again, where are they going? The bulk of them are going to Hatfield. And the next page, page 19, are the grade levels again.
Same type of math?
Yes. Page 20, this is our charter
our school charter out. And unfortunately, we're up a student going out. Last year in June, we had 41. This year, we have 42. And where are they going? Predominantly to Four Rivers. And I don't know what Four Rivers School is.
Greenfield.
It's a Greenfield?
In the parking lot of Greenfield Community College,
basically, yeah. Right out front.
And then those are the grade levels.
We have 22 children going.
So the last page is something that I added last year when we were doing some research for the charter and choice ballot question. So what I did was I took our choice and charter out and broke it down for you by town so you can see exactly where these kids are, you know, which kids are going. The Conway kids, the Deerfield kids, Sunderland kids, or Whately kids. So the numbers of students are on the left and the dollar amounts are on the right. And I just want to just bring to your attention that the where it says on the right, total choice charter, and it says Conway 222, 397, Deerfield 393, 081, and then Sunderland 215, and Whately 175. That's the actual cost of the students who are leaving those towns. But our agreement, our regional agreement, says that these costs get assessed by the percent breakdown. So per the agreement, even though $222,000 of it belongs to Conway, they'll only get assessed $152,000. And Deerfield, who only has $393,000 worth of choice and charter out, will pay $487,000.
And they have more money.
Well, I'm just breaking it up. Mr. Dicker has brought this up in the past, that this was another issue that the regional agreement doesn't speak to.
Yeah, it's a very important point, because there was no choice and charter at the time the original agreement was done.
Correct.
And
It's silent.
The statute should be amended to hold us harmless, and that they should be included as though they were enrolled in the student body.
Let's just wait until.
In this case here,
Conway's numbers are looking good, Bob. Move along.
It's costing.
But you have to get all four towns to vote on that.
Right, and you're not.
Unless you get
the
legislature restriction.
And you're not. It's like everything else. It's 2-2. So, unfortunately. Okay, so.
The one thing about this is that even though our choice numbers are up, it kind of obscures the fact that the number that we're losing to charter is still going up as well.
Yes.
And that I'd still just like to hold everybody to account for that, and just, you know, that Darius, you're making great progress every year. Get the outreach efforts get better and better, but there's still so much more that we can do.
But just the numbers, for every student that goes to charter, I have to get four students of school choice to replace them.
I know.
That's the math. It's 4-1. So it's.
I've always been able to understand going to PVA. I've always been able to understand the Chinese, you know, because we don't have that. That's different. But going to the Four Rivers Fraud Charter School, the Four Rivers Charter School, sorry, is just. Those are decisions that are just primarily based on just being poorly informed and or not informed, and that if we do just more outreach, I really think we can work on those numbers.
So just in closing, a couple of things. The assessment data hopefully we'll have by the end of this week, and the budget subcommittee meeting is going to meet at 5:00 before our next meeting to review that assessment data. Our E&D right now, as I mentioned earlier, is still in the process of being certified. It really is turning into a very different process. They keep asking me to send more and more data. So they did contact me today. They want one more analysis. But as Mr. Scanlon said, we should be getting our E&D in at 350. Having said that, I was notified with the first set of E&D papers that I submitted that we took an invalid vote. Great.
because we voted for the 28,000 and the moving costs after June 30th. So the E&D is done as of June 30th, and it's not open to be spent until it's recertified. So that vote is invalid. So when they give us our new E&D, which I think will be 350-202, we then have to re-vote the 28,000, which will then bring us down to about $322,000 left. So I did not know that. I'm surprised Mr. Decker did not call me out on that.
Not everything, Patty. We have to learn some things.
Are you getting too old for this now?
I am.
I think it was a very simple oversight that who would have thought that it was certified last year. It's ours. It's still ours. But apparently they shut the account down until it's recertified again, and then it opens up again. So
we won't make that mistake again. That's the bright side.
We'll make new mistakes.
Oh, sure. We can count on that.
Yeah, I just hope Governor Baker, gives us the money that we need for our schools, even though Governor Baker was trying to get more charter schools because, that was what he wanted, but our wonderful folks voted it down.
He has to run for election.
So I'm hoping he's not going to come in the back door and hurt us with other monies that are due to us.
Look at the cabinet nominee. Oh. And her stance on public education, if you want to get scared, but that's all another discussion.
Okay, moving along on the update of school choice and charter. I just have a question.
You already got it.
I gave that in the
front. No, I know that part. I was just reading, so I knew what I was talking about. In draft two, could we have also, on that last page, could we have a breakdown of male, female, and I don't know if special ed gets involved there. Like, are we bringing in students that... Male, female. I just like to know that. But are we
getting
special ed both?
Well, it's there because I don't identify students. You can just see the amount of money if you go to page.
No. I want to know if it's male, female, and special ed for choice and charter. They come in with a special ed.
The sped increment tells you that we're paying on the school choice sending, that this year we're going to send $30,275 additional dollars out for sped increment.
Right. All right. Can we know male and female next time?
Well, I'd
like to know if it's mostly girls going out or is it mostly boys? Because then, to your targeting question, how do you try to target them to bring them back in?
They're not identified as male, female, so there could be a problem with some names because some names.
We don't need names. We just need to know if it's a male or a female.
Well, the only thing I can tell by is their name. That's all I have is their name.
Okay, my question was surrounding how do we target to try to keep those people here?
Makes sense.
Sometimes knowing that if it's a male or a female or other, right. We can. Maybe check into that.
Well, and I'm saying, Cindy, I can do that, but the only thing I have to identify them is their name. And if you have a name that, like Riley, could be a boy, could be a girl, Chris. I would have no idea.
We got a bunch of those, yeah. We play that game. Yeah. Okay.
Can I have one more?
You can have as much as you want.
So, getting back to what I had talked about originally, you can take this with you, and if you have questions or things you want to know, email to Patty, or you can ask one of us. I'm not as good a student of this budget as Patty is, but I know pretty well what's in there, and so do most of the people on the budget subcommittee. We've been looking at it for a while. So another thing you probably see, we haven't talked about it much in budget subcommittee yet because we didn't have the assessment numbers. We wanted to know how the whole thing plays out in the bigger picture. We may be cooking up a capital article to take care of some of the things that Bob Lesko puts on that sheet that aren't really truly operating. Expenses, they don't belong in here because they don't recur. We may be picking some of those off of there, but we wanted to see first. I don't want to put it that way. What we wanted to see is the impact of the budget first on town finances, whether it's worth going through the trouble of trying to structure one of those, because we did it a couple years ago and it was a complete disaster trying to get money to pay for. Remember that, buy this, buy that, buy that. Everybody, all 4 towns, each one voted something different.
Yeah, that's right.
It was a complete disaster.
I think we got the truck.
We don't want to do that. Yeah, we got the truck. We got out of the deal. And everybody, they were scattered in every other direction, all the 4 towns, so we had no agreement on anything here, so you may be seeing something coming forward too for some of that stuff that Bob Lesko has on his list to get some of that stuff taken care of.
What if you had a question on it right now, like a big
exit?
You're running.
All right, I'm going to be sending you a question.
You're going to send me a question? You're going to send her a
no,
question?
No, I'm not sending you. You never respond. I'm just saying.
When was the last time you sent me a question?
Never. A year ago, last March.
She'll do a search. You'll find
anyways, me. Moving along. So I will be sending you a question.
You know where he lives.
So we are up to, we have the votes recorded there. So collaborative, any reports?
Me?
Yes, you.
Oh. No, there's a meeting tomorrow.
Okay.
So I'll drop stuff off at your office, or your office, whoever wants it. But I'm getting frequent emails about, I'm sure you are too, about classes that teachers can take, and most of us are getting certified, recertified this spring. So they should check out the website, find out about services that they can, you know, bump up their PD for.
We do pass those along. Mm-hmm. We pass those along daily to our staff.
Good.
We get they send it to us directly.
Good. You know, we don't get information about, you know, what schools are taking classes through them. I wish we would kind of get a breakdown of that so we know, you know, what information is getting to teachers and who's taking advantage of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All you have to do is ask Bill. You're a silly. Somebody will give you the information.
Publishing somebody down for
yeah.
It.
We could. We could do it by billing because any teachers that do professional development through there get reimbursement to there. We could figure out how much programs are being because I know it goes up and down just from what you know. I sign off on all of them, and so I have it in a sense. But it goes up and down depending on demand. Like with you know SEI training, that went way up, and then you know some other ones went down. So we could do that.
Thank you, principal.
I took a personal day today because my kids are home. And I got the neighbor's kids too.
Well, at least you didn't take a sick day.
Exactly. Well, mine are one and the same, I think. All right. So I did have, this is the, we're talking about the transition to middle school. This is a flyer I'm sending home to parents. It's probably going out, I was supposed to go out today, so it's probably going out tomorrow. For the sixth grade parents, just so you have an idea to pass on if you know people who want to know more. And you know, as was said, my biggest goal for the information sessions for sixth grade parents is that they make, if they are deciding to go somewhere else, I try not to get into the game of passing judgment on people who are choosing different options. I have my opinions of charter schools and that kind of stuff, but I do want to make sure they, if they do choose a different option, they are doing so with the correct information. Because there's a lot of rumors out there in any community about schools, what they offer, what they don't offer, and instead of going off of rumors, we want them to make sure they are making educated decisions about what we offer here and what we do here. So, I just gave this out to you so that if you have anybody who is asking you as school committee members, I really encourage people who are questioning to do coffee with the principal. That's when they come during the school day, and I really can go around and show them classes in action. It's not for everyone. If people are in the system and they have kids that have already gone ahead of the sixth graders now, you know, the sixth grade parent information is just fine. But those who want a little bit more, I mean, I walk them into classes, they see class sizes, they see types of instruction, they see the technology we have, they see you know, lab science that we have, and I even bring them to the high school so they can see how it all fits together. So it really is, I like that. And I show them the arts and all the other great stuff that's going on in the building. So encourage those people. And I will, if they can't make those dates, I will even
we may be make a point. That night, so you might have to be in two places at once.
I know. We rolled the dice.
We have the 28th scheduled.
I spoke to the boss, and I rolled the dice on that one. So, you know.
Depending on
so
how it goes.
What's that?
So you jinxed us, is what you said.
No.
Stop. We'll see how it goes.
Stop. You got to bring it up, though. No. The other thing I have is that, you know, we're closing out the semester this week, finals Thursday and Friday. MCAS, we talked a little bit about that, but our middle school teachers are going to be doing practice tests with the students online. We're hoping to do that on Friday as well. I talked about the transition, so I don't know, we're kind of in the middle of things. Unless there are any questions about anything else going on?
Question, on your step-up day, you're having the classes from each one of the towns come in that day.
Correct.
Now, if there were the prospective student from another town,
what happens?
Are they getting invited?
Yes, they are.
Also for that same day?
Yes, they are. So again, all the school choices kids who are part of those classes are all coming. The whole class comes whether they say they're going somewhere else or not. They're all coming. It's part of being one, trying to be one district. Any students who are school choice and filled out paperwork would come at that time. Any students who are currently choice somewhere else, perhaps, and we've had some of these who were coming back to us from middle school, come during that day as well. So,
are you going to be running an ad looking for choice kids to come in? And do you want to, if you are you going to add something, come take a look on the step up day? Just let us know you're coming ahead of time.
So,
if you don't want to do it, that's fine.
Let me tell you the reason why we haven't been doing that. Marty did that as principal probably about 5 years ago. You guys remember the radio commercial and that kind of stuff. We got mixed results from the community about that. Us going, reaching out, the perception of that. The amount of enrollments that we got in from doing all that, they really didn't increase. The majority of our kids are coming, starting with us in the elementaries and working their way through. Kids who come to us, starting the choice at the middle level, maybe we get one or two more. Those things are very expensive. It's, $500 an ad. If you do the math, it might be worth it. Dr. Carrie and I can talk about it. That's something she wants to do. I've kind of, looking at this class coming in, I also would question whether or not we want to expand that class even more. It's one of those, again, it's, if we add staff to it, we then could open it up. And so I already have some applications for school choice, and I told the parents they're going to have to wait till late spring before I can get a decision on that. Whether or not we're going to
be. If they put in an application, can they come and shadow for a day?
They do. They do. Many, we have kids shadow, I don't want to say all the time, but quite frequently there's kids shadowing to take a look at programs and that kind of stuff.
I know I've talked to you before about this, but I definitely have a sense that all these transition steps are wonderful, but that they're all just too late. That in the school year, that parents are being bombarded in the summer between fifth and sixth grade by charters and privates to begin, and they're going to informational sessions in September and October at all those places. And we are getting into this in February of the following year. And you're really addressing the people that have already either not taken any active interest in, that they're already, we need to, the people that are actively considering other options are doing it in the fall. Mm-hmm. And that was the feedback, we sent Charlene Allen, mm-hmm, to the schools, which was very well received. But I heard from multiple people that, boy, that would have been better a couple of months or even earlier.
I get it. And so let me I'll give you the honest kind of scoop on that. I don't have an admissions department. Okay?
I know.
These private schools do. Okay?
I know.
So it's, I can move things forward. I don't know. If Charlene Allen, our guidance director, visited all the elementary schools to talk to the kids about the opportunities at Frontier, she did so. Actually, Dr. Carey kind of made that happen earlier this fall.
This fall, early.
And so if that's too early, if we got to get them into the fifth grade, or fifth grade summer, again, those who are looking elsewhere, there's usually a motivation of a judgment about Frontier that is made correct or, we're not correct most of the time, that they want something different. They want grass is greener. They want, And so, again, it's about, charter is the biggest one. We don't get a lot of choice because of dislike for Frontier. It's the other side of Waitley that's going to Smith Academy. They're closer to Smith Academy than they are Frontier. Their friends are all in that area. They're baseball friends or whatever. Some of these other ones, they're looking for a different kind of.
I think that's true but that there's a percentage of people that are looking at these charter and private because they themselves went to private, their parents, and that they're following their own family patterns, and that they're not, by the time we present them with this information, they're no longer open, mm-hmm, calendar-wise to receiving it, whereas they would have been. And that the other thing, that rather than rather than advertisements and whatnot, I think that we would be really better served if we could toot our own horn more and put more. For instance, we had a social studies department chairperson that wrote a textbook for Connecticut Valley Humanities Advanced Placement, which is an amazing accomplishment. And I would love to see a profile that should be tooted up big time, and that the years-long effort and expense that we put into creating something like that is something like that does so much better, I think, than, I mean, that's really effective. It shows what we have in so many different ways, and especially given what Mohawk's going through right now with their front page parent revolt.
So I don't mean to cut you off.
Yes, sorry. I was finished right then anyway.
You were going to quit anyways. I just wanted to start moving along, and we can actually pick up on that, just a continuing thread throughout. So before I turn it over to the superintendent, is that all you have, sir?
It was on questions and answers. Yep.
Okay. So before I turn it over to the superintendent, I received a phone call this morning from a parent. And I said, hello. And I heard, I like this superintendent. And I go,
cool.
Why? Because she gives us, like, warning the night before that we're going to have a two-hour delay, and then comes back on, so I didn't have to get up early with the kids. I let them sleep. And then school was canceled. I didn't have to touch them. Everybody kind of slept in. I thought it was great. So I wanted to pass that along. So you got one person in your corner anyway. I thought it was a really kind of cute thing that they didn't have to deal with three kids running around going crazy in the morning. And so that was nice. So thank you for doing that. Seems to be working again for one family. But you've got to start, I think you have that little motto, start with one family.
Yeah.
If student, you noticed it, the dismissal time today, it was sleeting. And
it
very
was
slippery
horrible.
Out here.
Oh, yeah.
Right. It was a good call. It's a tough call. And we all know that, by the way, as parents, what you all go through. But yeah, it was a good call.
So part of my superintendent's report, and you'll be able to read the whole version if you go on to the Frontier Union 38 website. It's my superintendent's message for January, how we start. But there are 9 to 10 other superintendents in Franklin County, and we start. We started Sunday afternoon. We realized Monday wasn't going to be a problem. Then we go. We started last night about 5. I wanted to make, we, a couple of us knew Athol Orange over there, Maureen Marshall is always calling. You know, she's the one on top. That's Worcester Thomas. But anyhow, so we knew it was going to be a two-hour delay. Other ones wanted to wait, and I wanted to get my call in by 7 last night. And so I did, because I knew it was going to be a two-hour delay. In the morning, we start at 4 o'clock, and we go back and forth, back and forth. And I also consult with our road crews. This is the very first time that Ron Sweet, is it Sweet or
yep, Sweet?
We actually requested a closing, and I was really surprised. However, I did know that while it was going to be raining in Deerfield, it was going to be ice pellets, not sleet, but ice pellets in Conway. And again, the school buses, the employees, we have so many employees coming and going. Everyone's safety is the utmost. So it really wasn't a big stretch for me to call it cancel. On a normal day, if I had no prior warning to the families, I would have done it at 5:45 because of those high school students out there in the dark getting on the bus at 6:30. However, this morning I did hold off until 6:20, 6:15, because everyone already knew that it was a two-hour delay to begin with. I do try to notify parents the night before. In fact, pretty much I will always do it if it's humanly possible, because daycare is such a hard, it impacts just about every family. What are we going to do? Where are they going to go? It's 2 hours. I wish I had known. So this helps them prepare their children, themselves, where they're going. And it also sets the kids up for a better day coming in 2 hours late. They know ahead of time at night, they get that adjustment. Time on learning is better spent. So, and there's a million other kinds of things that go on. I follow NOAA, I follow trajectory of the storm, but mostly I rely on my colleagues in other school districts and my road crews. And every town in this this regional district is fantastic. The guys are great. You know, I've got Scarborough and Keith and Ron and they're all just really great with me. So thank you. And that's my thing. But I do have to ask one thing. There's a couple of things. One of the things that I did not bring up to the budget committee that I'm going to bring up in the full school committee next month is the issue of the SRO. Marty Barrett signed an MOU with the Deerfield Police Department last May, I believe, talking about if this, you know, what the SRO does and what's expected, but if the school committee agrees, we would pick up $15,700 of the SRO salary. Deerfield Academy pays for, I think, $30,000, and I don't know if Eagleburg or another school might be picking up. And I would like Chief Pichurik and Officer Ravish to come in and speak to what they do and really let you know what's going on. If we put that $15,700 in our budget, according to Patty, it'll raise our budget 0.4. So it's
0.11. We go from 3% to 3.14, but it'll be a little bit higher because I used 15,000. I'm sorry, I didn't hear 15,700. 15,000.
It's a little more. So it would bring it a hair over. But I would like just the Frontier Regional School Committee to make a decision.
Isn't the town paying for that?
Well, they would be assessed. They're assessing us, basically.
I just remember last town meeting last year, I thought we approved an SRO through the town budget.
You did, because when they came to us, we had already been through our budget process. They came to us too
right.
late. So I think Deerfield picked
up.
Oh,
so that was
cost.
Only a one-time, mm-hmm. that was only one.
So the MOU, and I will bring the MOU next time, or I could even email it to the committees, the one that Marty signed last year, so that you'll have an upgrade. And so we can have some discussion ensuing around that. The other thing I wanted to point out is I asked Darius to send this letter home, and it is about our water levels, the lead in the copper that was found in the school district when they did the testing. Bob Lesko, and rightly so, consulted with me about volunteering for this state-funded testing, which we did. And essentially what they found was 17 locations in this building. However, they took a first draft. And many of these faucets aren't used. They're in labs. They're not, you know, it's not drinkable water, but they took a first draft and it had high lead or high copper. We don't really know the impact of copper, but some of them had lead. And
there was only one with lead.
Only one with lead. Then they run it 30 seconds and then they take another, and none of them, the lead was gone, and the copper, they were all within safe limits. So we sent this home so that the families would be aware, and the state has also given us some information. What he's done is he's closed off the faucets right now that did come with the first draft with copper. Mostly copper was the problem, it was one with lead. What we will do is eventually, I think the plan is to institute a regular flushing of the pipes for all the faucets for, you know, to ensure that there won't be any leftover residual kind of metals that might build up in the things. But essentially the drinking fountains and all that, they were fine. We closed one drinking fountain, but we had a nice filtered water one anyway. They invested in a nice one, and we're hoping to invest in another one that would give us cold filtered water that we could fill our water bottles from. So I wanted you to be aware of that. Nothing at all, no danger. Everyone's going to be fine. There's no lead poisoning going on here. Again, one faucet. Copper, 30 seconds, there was no residue. So that's all I have.
And did that letter come home today?
The letter was being folded and put in on Friday and Monday. So I don't know if they put it into the mail on yesterday. And so either you got it today, if you didn't get it today, it's going out tomorrow because they were working on it. we have two mailings going out at the same time. So we have that sixth grade one, and that one came down. So
thanks for not pulling a Flint, Michigan on us.
Yeah. Yeah. Is everybody happy with the move?
Oh, I must tell you, and I must thank you all. It was a phenomenal move. It was very easy. It was 6 months of planning. Darius prepared the way beautifully. I mean, the stuff he had to go through and clean out for us to be able to move in. Everything was spick and span. I think Bob Lesko, I can't sing his praises enough, because the details he took care of, and he's still taking care of. The IT department right there got everyone, hardwired in, the electricity. The offices are beautiful, and my office is lovely. I'm very pleased. I think overall, 99%, it was absolutely perfect,
Is there anything that you need that we didn't plan for?
Absolutely not.
The only thing we're waiting for are those Warren articles to get the air conditioning.
Yes.
Which we don't need right now.
I'm not sure who else went through them, but I came in a couple weeks ago, went to everybody's office to see how everybody was doing, and for the most part, everybody was doing well, and still unpacking, but if maybe next meeting.
For the most part, you qualified with. For the most part,
he came the day, the 5 minutes after.
Well, a couple of people were still unpacking stuff,
And let me just say too, I want to give a shout out to Dr. Carey, because the day that we were moving, the office did not report. She came in that day and worked with the movers to make sure that everybody's boxes got to the exact right room. She unpacked the entire multi-purpose room and got all our supplies out, which made our coming in just much more seamless, because that we didn't have to worry about. And our boxes were there to be unpacked, and that was a yeoman's effort on her part. I just want to thank her.
That excited Cindy.
Yeah. Because she did a great job. She told us we'd be fine, and we are.
My hallmark is calm. It'll be okay. It'll be fine.
We'll be adjourned.
No. Judy.
No, I'm sorry.
First.
I didn't see you. I'm sorry.
Do students have access to the superintendent's area, like after school? Like, do they know where it is and how to find it? I mean, I'm asking. My daughter needed a work permit signed. Usually,
they walk through
Ronda.
The halls. They still use the hallways at lunchtime.
So yeah, they can go.
Oh yeah, we're waiting for our new signs, that say superintendents, and but Rhonda's office is right there, and she's it's open access, but not too many kids use that part of the building. It's just our life skills students, and I hear them on the stairwell, and I just love that pitter patter. It's a bang bang bang, but I love that pitter.
Now I'll take a motion to adjourn.
We'll adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.